Hey, Dad.
Hi, Elliot.
Hey, Dad. Trying to get this slideshow to work.
Oh, you're in charge of the Zoom tonight?
Oh. Elliot and Al, look at us. You guys kind of look alike.
Hey,
hi, David. How are you?
Doing good? Trying to get this slideshow to work.
Oh. Is it PowerPoint?
It doesn't want to run itself. I could sit here and keep clicking on it, but that seems really silly.
Is it PowerPoint?
No, it's just a Google Photo album slideshow. It runs on its own when I'm in Google, but when I go to hit screen share, it doesn't run on its own.
No. Can't help you there. If it was PowerPoint, I did lots and lots and lots of PowerPoints in my day. But
yeah, I didn't think of doing it that way.
Happy to not do this anymore. So this is, does your shul have this Sunday night slot? Often, yeah?
Yeah, pretty often. Can you see the slideshow, Dad?
I see two slides, yeah. The iris.
Do you see the slideshow advancing?
Yeah. You don't see it?
It's not advancing.
It's not advancing?
No. Okay, it just advanced?
Yeah, because I just clicked it.
Yeah.
Oh, so maybe you're going to have to click it.
Well, that's annoying hi, Tamar. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. I'm trying to get this slideshow to go on its own, but it doesn't want to. I also made up a playlist for the event.
Oh, what's on it?
Oh, now you're getting complicated here.
No, it's not complicated.
Playlist and a slideshow. No.
You want to share it with me?
Yeah, yeah.
Now and then give me co-host and you'll let people in and I'll do the slideshow.
Okay. That's clever. I emailed it to myself, so I just need to open my email.
So I see here that I am a co-host, so I'll be able to put up my own slides.
Good.
Once the talk starts, right?
Yes.
Okay.
How come it's not here? I sent it to myself. No, I didn't send it to myself here. I just have to send it from this email.
So I'll log in from my computer.
Okay.
Like, I know, isn't it great? Oh, you're already there.
Yeah. Oh, not on mute either. So I'm mute on mute.
Now Susan Blaine's voice I hear.
That's me.
How come, where's my playlist? Thank you. Hey, Susan Blaine.
Hi, Elliot.
Hi, Susan.
Hi, how are you, Al?
Good, how are you?
Jean.
Okay.
Hi, Jean and Stephen. How are you guys tonight?
Old pirates, yes, they rabbi. Sold I to the merchant ships.
My son is actually on a big Bob Marley kick
minutes
right now.
Minutes after day to guy.
Have you heard? You'll hear in a moment the Johnny Cash version. This is a playlist of great songs of great covers. There's a fabulous Johnny Cash cover.
By the end of the Almighty, we forward in this generation.
Probably like most schools, we are generally notoriously late to get on any kind of program. So let's just let this roll for a while.
Okay.
My show was notoriously
remember
off.
Remember to rest the stop. Elliot.
Oh, he has to
yeah.
do the slideshow.
What's up?
Do the slideshow.
Oh, Rachel was going to do the slideshow.
Did you send it to me?
Did I?
Well, I can't run it from here if I don't have access to it.
That's a portrait of you.
Yeah.
This is one of my favorites. Tamar, I know you love these these portraits. These.
Very
I love this picture. It's 1975. What are we going to do with this canvas, Dad?
What
are we going to do with this canvas? I can't imagine hanging it up in a living room.
Well, I don't know. It's what you think?
Hey, David and Aviva, how you guys doing? Sadia, you're a little young for this.
I'll change the name.
That's okay.
We've got to fulfill the book.
I thought the slides would go on their own.
I thought it just started.
Hi, Lois.
Who am I looking at? Oh, sure.
Yeah. Am I? Can you see me?
Yeah, I'm glad you're on.
I'm in my nightgown.
Oh, my God. But aren't there other people here, too?
I guess so. I'm going to turn my camera off.
I would do that.
Fix your head.
Stephen, hi.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi.
Stephen. You're Stephen.
Who's that? Yes, I know my internet.
Avery, Steve, how you doing?
Hi.
Take my money, my cigarettes. I haven't seen the worst of
myself and what.
Dave, how do you like that picture?
Wow.
It's net zero. It's got like with the solar, it's at the grid.
I'm going to wait another couple of minutes because we do tend to run late.
What does that mean, we tend to run late? I don't know.
People don't tend to come on time. Hey, Alexander. What's that behind you?
Oh, just a little Jackson Pollock I picked up a few years ago.
Nice. Hey, Marcy and Rob.
Hi.
Hey.
Let's see, we gotta figure out how to mute ourselves. Whoops, Jess says hello.
Jess.
Okay, how do we mute ourselves so we don't bother you? Oh, there we go.
Just click the little mute button. We're gonna start in another minute.
It's
promise.
That's where if that happens, you just reboot it.
Yeah, thank you. Oh, this is great.
We haven't really even gotten started, and it's great. All right, I'm going to get started now. Hi, everyone. It is delightful to have you all here. I just want to try and see everybody all at once. Wow, this is great. I can't take it all in, so I don't get totally overwhelmed. I'm going to just click over this way. So let me get started tonight. Many on the Zoom know my mother. There's my brother, Steve. Wave, Steve. And my father, Dad. Wave hello. No, my mother, my father's wife, Ray Raff, only as the artist behind the pictures hanging in our apartment, some of which I just had running on the slideshow. I would like to take just a brief minute to share a little bit about who she was and her life. Ray Paula Klein was born on April 8th, 1938, to Herman and Laura Klein. Herman Klein was born in rural Hungary, left home as a teenager with a cousin, and made his way to America. Laura Klein was born in New York City, one of five sisters and a brother, and worked with her beloved sister Ida as a bookkeeper. Laura named Mom for her older sister Ray, who died childless shortly before Mom's birth. But Mom told me once that Laura could never bring herself to call Mom by her given name, and instead always called Mom by her nickname, which must have been given to her early after her birth, Bunny. She was born shortly before Pesach, after all. Bunny's worldview was profoundly affected by the death of nearly all of her father's family in the Shoah, and by the fact that both of her parents spent long hours running the family business Klein Cleaners of Locust Valley, New York, a business that still bears the name Klein Cleaners 40 years after our grandfather sold it. Bunny was talented in both music and art, but decided to pursue art. Having met my dad while still a student at Glen Cove High School, she spent 1 year at Syracuse, a second at Columbia, before settling down at the School of the Museum of Fine Arts at Tufts University, also known as the Boston Museum School, where she got her degree and was a dedicated fan of the school. Classically trained, Mom's art never fit easily into any box, She roamed across media and styles and was constantly evolving. Rarely would she ever talk about her work. Mom was, however, also a consummate educator, working as an art teacher at various schools before settling down for 25 years at the Long Island High School for the Arts, where she taught junior and senior studio and helped dozens of students find and gain confidence in their vision, develop skills, blossom as artists, and win scholarships to the finest art schools in the country. Mom was really, really, really into her family. She was like a sister to her first cousins, Ruthie, Phyllis, and Julie, an aunt to their children, and an extra grandparent to their children's children. First cousins, second cousins, cousins once or twice removed, everyone called my mom Aunt Bunny. And Aunt Bunny knew everybody's business, participated in their lives, their life events, and kept everyone apprised of all that was going on throughout the extended family. Mom died October 1, 2018, just more than 3 years ago, but her presence is still very much a part of our lives, and may her memory be for a blessing and her soul ascend to the heights. Tonight, shortly after Mom's third yard site, we have the pleasure of hearing from Tamar Avishai, our guest speaker. Tamar is an art historian and independent producer based in Shaker Heights, Ohio, formerly of Boston. She's the one-woman band behind The Lonely Palette, a fabulous podcast. Everybody, take your phone, open the podcast app, whatever you listen to, type in search, Lonely Palette, and immediately subscribe and download the entire back catalog. Just do it. Trust me. Trust Simi Chevelle, who I told to do it, and he's smiling and nodding. It's fabulous. You'll be amused, entertained, informed. Your worldview will expand, and you'll never think about art or Western history the same way again. Do it. Her podcast has won a lot of awards, started podcasting out of the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, and has also run shows from the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, the Harvard Art Museums, the Addison Gallery of American Art, and Open Source with Christopher and Leiden. And since 2020, she's been podcaster in residence at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. It is my pleasure now to turn it over to Tamar for tonight's presentation. Tamar, please, I look forward to it.
Thank you.
And again, if everyone can please mute so that we can just keep our attention on Tamar and what she's going to be showing us.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Elliot. I really appreciate having it put that way, because you know, when you're a one-woman band and you're just kind of slogging away alone, a little lonely, as it were. You know, it's really nice to know that it reaches people. So thank you. So before I actually jump in, I'm going to share my screen here. And one thing that I was told after giving one of these talks, can everyone see? Is that I should have made it clear that there is nudity in some of these artworks. So just so you know, I'm putting it out there that there is a disclaimer that there is some nudity in some of these artworks. So, but I assume that everyone in this group can handle it. So this idea of modern art with a Jewish soul, Elliot basically gave me a challenge. We were looking through his mother's work, and as you just saw from the slideshow, it's incredibly eclectic. It's really good. And we wanted to talk about what would be the most meaningful way to bring together, you know, different ideas of Judaism, of modernism, specifically modern art, which is my area of expertise, and to talk about how her work referenced a lot of really important artists in the 20th century. By her own admission, you know, she was really influenced by so much art of the 20th century, and kind of what modernism really means. And so the idea of the challenge of kind of bringing all of this together, this came to, it felt like the idea of a Jewish soul was the best way to approach this. It's easy for me to explain modern art. The idea of explaining a Jewish soul is a little bit more complicated. And I want to be clear, actually, that this is not going to be a talk about Jewish art. And we'll kind of explain the difference. But if you're familiar with the classical definition of Jewish art, then you're probably familiar with the tradition of an iconism, which basically means that it's art that doesn't actually represent figures or human figures. And so obviously compared to Christian art, it's quite a difference. You know, we're very used to seeing the New Testament, we're very used to seeing Christ in, you know, any number, you know, kind of the entire trajectory of his life. And we don't actually have that same ability to look at Jewish art and kind of the capturing of Jewish storytelling in the same way. And there's a reason for that. And iconism really kind of believes that depicting God in any human form or concrete form is akin to idolatry. And so it's the same in Islam. You know, it's why the depiction of the Prophet Muhammad is so verboten. And that really means that for a long time, Jews weren't really in control of their own iconography. So this is the Arch of Titus depicting the sack of Jerusalem. I mean, this is an incredibly tragic moment in Jewish history. And it's actually presented as a pretty triumphant moment in Roman history. And the iconography of the menorah is so powerful, you know, and I always felt like maybe I saw it a little bit differently than some of my classmates did when I looked at this in school, because it was so representative of the narrative that wasn't the Jewish side of the narrative. It was the Roman side of the narrative. And so it's like, you know, people have gotten used to seeing Jewish art, you know, quote unquote, Jewish imagery represented not by Jews. And so it's interesting, you know, there's kind of a loss to the idea that Jews don't really have their own same kind of rich iconographic tradition that Christian art does. But at the same time, there's a sacredness too. You know, if there are no images of God to be destroyed, you know, you can't actually destroy an image of God. And so, you know, it's just an interesting kind of different way of looking at art history. But this is all to say, so just kind of a quick example of the kind of Jewish art that does exist. And this is more kind of the aniconic tradition. This is a tympanum in Prague of a synagogue, and you'll see a lot more, you know, of kind of natural elements, which can't really be destroyed in the same way. You know, iconoclasm was actually a big problem in Christian art, which has not been the same way in Jewish art. But this is all to say, we're not looking at Jewish art tonight. What we are looking at then is, what does it mean to think about what a Jewish soul is? And this is where things get subjective. You know, I'm not gonna mince words here. This is very much actually kind of my own personal take here, where I freely let myself look at art in the 20th century. Again, art that I've, you know, poured my career into, art that is so meaningful to me, that isn't actually Jewish, but taps into something much deeper about modernism and modernity. You know, so much of what we define as modernism is a collective understanding of the subjective individual. And we're going to come back to that a lot. So, but this idea of the subjective individual, you know, the idea of Judaism has always meant to me the importance of my own subjectivity going into it, of a kind of question asking that doesn't necessarily provide any one concrete answer, but that it's in the beauty and the intellectualism of asking the question. And that means that there's a lot of experimentation as you're kind of thinking through different ideas, different intellectual ideas, different, you know, different parsha, you know, kind of thinking about the different ways that you can come to different subjective answers. There is also a sense of meditative mindfulness that will come up in kind of interesting elements of modernity. That comes up in Jewish law, you know, in kashrut. You know, that's something that I think people feel that very deeply and very personally, and that it's meditative, and that it is, you know, to be able to keep kosher, there's a mindfulness that you are bringing to the world in terms of how you go through the world and kind of taking time out to follow tradition, to, you know, keep kosher. And that we, as a collective, as a community, I mean, we're being a community right now, that we support one another in terms of our own individual communion with spirituality. And I was reading your philosophy, the philosophy of your temple online, talking about this big tent philosophy. And I don't think that it's too much of a stretch to say that modern artists in the 20th century followed that same big tent idea, that they were all kind of supporting as a collective this pursuit of an individual subjective way of looking at the world. So I wanted to pair these ideas up, and I wanted to look at this, you know, if I've just described kind of what the Jewish soul means to me, then I pulled out some artists. Again, I was talking to Elliot about this, and these are artists who meant a lot to his mother, and these are artists who have meant so much to the 20th century and are very helpful in our understanding of really what modernity meant from the art historical standpoint. So that's the setup. And this is where we get into kind of individual storytelling, like storytelling of these individual artists and how they link back to these larger ideas. So let's talk actually, let's define our terms. If we're going to talk about modernism, then we need to consider what was really the turning point of, you know, going from the 19th century into the 20th century. And you have this very interesting movement called post-impressionism. And post-impressionism as a definition itself, like as a name itself, is totally meaningless. You know, a critic in 1907 looks back at a very kind of odd period and says, okay, well, let's take the last impressionist exhibition in 1888 and Cezanne's death in 1906 and bookend the two and say, okay, this is post-impressionism. Because of course, impressionism was one of these first very radical avant-garde movements. I mean, we forget that now because it's so popular. We forget that, you know, because of the mugs and the mouse pads that, you know, Monet was, you know, a pretty revolutionary painter. And that the impressionists in general, the fact that they were painting life as it was being lived very, very quickly, that you had light as its own subject matter, that you were really trying to capture the world as it was happening. You know, painting had never seen that before. And so impressionism, you know, separated itself from the Parisian salon, from the Parisian art establishment. They had their own separate exhibitions, and that was a real turning point in art becoming created for its own sake and not just to be part of a kind of larger, I hate to say this, you know, kind of almost a machine of the Parisian art establishment, where there's a real step away from that to make art about liberating your subject matter, liberating your technique, and really having artists who were curious about how they could push this medium along, exhibiting separately and exhibiting together, separate from the establishment, together as artists. So 1888 was the year of the final Impressionist exhibition. They disbanded after that. And you had the next generation of artists who are almost always kind of pared down to the big four, which we're looking at now. So you have Cézanne, going clockwise, you have Cézanne, you have Seurat, you have Gauguin, and you have Van Gogh. And these are four artists who, when you actually look at them all together, don't really have a lot to do with each other. You know, you don't look at these paintings and think that there is a real commonality between the four. And in a lot of ways, there wasn't, which is why having a critic come along in 1907 and just kind of lumping them together is, you know, a little bit problematic from a history point of view. But it encourages us to actually think about what they do have in common. And so you have these four artists, enormously famous artists, who all are connected with a couple, kind of three main ideas. One is that they borrowed really heavily from the Impressionist palette. They hated Impressionism. That was another one. They felt that Impressionism, that there was too much of an unfinished element to it. And so you ended up with, you know, paintings that they didn't see as kind of slow, built up, ponderous enough. And, you know, any one of these paintings would have taken a much longer time to paint than the average Impressionist painting. And the third, which is actually really the most important and is going to kind of bring us into modernism, is that all four of these are really dependent on subjectivity, really dependent on subjectivity, which is so much the cornerstone of what modernism is. This idea that we all recognize that we bring our own subjective realities to the world and that there is no actual capital T truth. You know, there is no omniscient narrator who's kind of explaining the world to us, but we can only see things through our own perspectives. And a really good example of this from literature actually is the book Mrs. Dalloway, also a very important modernist piece of literature, because every chapter is spoken from the perspective of a different character. And so much of the book kind of takes place inside their heads. There's no narrator. And at the time too, that was enormously revolutionary. So if you want to kind of really understand what a lot of these artists were getting at, think of the Mrs. Dalloway complex. So we're going to focus, though, specifically on Cézanne. And he has been called the father of modern art. I mean, if you've ever taken an art history, a modern art history exam, that's always the like the question, you know, the essay question, why is Cézanne the father of modern art? And the reason is, you know, we're looking at a still life. We're looking at a really otherwise unremarkable still life. He's in his studio, he sets this up, and we have a basket of apples, we have a wine bottle, we have these pastries, we have the drop cloth, and we have the table. And you realize as you look at it that it doesn't add up. It doesn't really make sense when you're looking at it from a visual perspective. You accept it, but when you start to actually break it down, you realize that you're not seeing something that makes a whole lot of sense. The way that you're looking at the top of the pastries and the side of the bottle, the way that the table looks like it would just collapse. You know, how is that cloth staying on? How are those apples not rolling off? And this is a really important turning point in him trying to create an objective exercise, a rational exercise here, trying to capture his own subjectivity. Because when he is painting this painting, he is not always going to see it from the exact same standpoint every single time. No matter how good an artist you are, you move around a little bit, you get up, you come back, you get a snack, you turn your head, you know, and he's recognizing that these multiple kind of overlapping successive perceptions is what he wants to convey. So what we're seeing really is, in his mind, an objective exercise, because still lives almost always are exercises, an objective exercise in capturing subjectivity, in really putting his finger on the pulse of the modernist moment. This had enormous influence on Picasso, and we'll come back to that. But moving on kind of in from artist to artist, kind of story to story, and if you saw, again, the slideshow, there was a portrait on that same kind of butcher paper with the light around the body that Raff painted that is very, should I call her Bunny? I have my notes. Okay, that feels very, very intimate. But clearly, you know, there was influence in the work of Egon Schiele And this is also a turning point. This is, you know, kind of early, around the same time as Cezanne's painting. You know, Schiele came, he was in Vienna, Cezanne was in Paris. But Egon Schiele, you know, if you recognize anything about his work, again, I want to focus on this idea of incredible subjectivity. His work is his rawness. You always feel like you're kind of getting a backstage pass into his psyche by looking at his work. And there's a reason for that. I mean, because Vienna at this time is going to be a little bit different culturally than Paris was. Vienna was the birthplace of psychoanalysis at this point. And so I think that the term was established in 1896, Freud, of course. This idea of psychoanalysis entering the mainstream discourse is basically, it's championing the most objectively self-centered thing a person can do, which is recognize, again, the value of their own subjectivity, of their own viewpoint onto the world. And so you have artists like Schiele who are stripping away the facade, who are really getting into the distilling their bodies down to their basic elements. And using a mirror to do it. The mirror became really, really important with self-portraiture and just portraiture in general. And so this middle drawing, this is my favorite drawing ever. I can't get enough of it because, you know, you have the vulnerability of this one line, this kind of naked pencil mark on the drawing, on the page. There's no place to hide. You know, his line always has to be dead on accurate, and it almost always is, or at least the art that, you know, he put out into the world. And because of this use of a mirror, you do have this intense eye contact. You have this wonderful image where he is looking at himself, looking at her, she's looking at herself being drawn. The way that the perspectives are played with here is genius. And you don't even notice how unfinished it is. I think that that's also really important that, you know, he eliminates the background to really get to the core of the figure. And you really feel like you're getting to their emotional core as well. There was actually a show at the Museum of Fine Arts in 2018 where they compared, well, not really compared and contrast, but the curators had drawings of both Gustav Klimt, who was, for all intents and purposes, for a while, Schiele's mentor, and Schiele's drawings. And you had the two side by side. And it was so clear that Klimt, even though Klimt is, of course, a tremendous artist, that his drawings just didn't even, like his line, just didn't even hold a candle to Schiele's. Because what you're seeing with Klimt was usually a preparatory drawing for a painting. And so you did get that sense of kind of backstage, like you'd kind of like caught the drawing with its pants down almost. But with Schiele, the drawing was always it. Even when he incorporated some painting into it, you know, his interest in depicting drawing itself and the line itself was so important to him. And so I would imagine why in doing her own portraiture, this would have been so meaningful to Bunny as well and so informative. So this idea of the subjective individual, add on this idea of question asking, of experimentation. And like with Cezanne, we'll kind of see what this does to the 20th century. So Pablo Picasso had basically just kind of blown into Paris in 1906, again, what's considered the final year of post-impressionism. And because that was the year that Cezanne died, there was a retrospective of his work in Paris. And Picasso attended it. And he was absolutely moved by it, by this idea of, again, you know, looking back at the fruit on the table, that you can objectively capture multiple overlapping successive perceptions by one person. And so analytic cubism, which is what we're looking at now, which was co-founded, Picasso and George Braque were kind of, you know, almost the brothers from another mother, like in the way that they collaborated on analytic cubism. They were really interested almost in taking Cézanne's apples to the next level. And it wasn't just a question of one person's successive perceptions kind of piled on top of each other. But what would happen if we were seeing, again, you know, if modernity is there is no one singular truth, if everything, if the world around us is really just everyone's perception of it, then what does that look like? If you have a portrait of a woman, if you have a woman, what does she look like when she is actually comprised of every perception of anyone who has ever experienced her? And not only are we looking at everyone's perception of her at once, but he talks about, Picasso talks about how you're also seeing these perceptions in duration, how it's not just, you know, because what is perception? Perception is never fixed. So what if your opinion of her changed? I mean, it's kind of a crude way of putting it, but it's like, how can you possibly try to capture a person as they are when really you are only seeing your own experience of her, and you have to see everyone's experience of her to really understand her truth? It's an incredibly intellectual exercise. And it's meant to be rational, which is really interesting, because I think it's important to point out that we're not actually seeing an abstract painting. This is not abstraction. This is, in Picasso and Braque's mind, a completely rational exercise, the way that Cézanne's still life is. It is a completely rational exercise in understanding how modernity shapes our perceptions, or how our perceptions actually comprise what modernity is. You know, if the world itself is constructed by our own experiencing of it, this is an illustration of that. This is a rational illustration of that. So Picasso was really interested in putting his finger on modernity and also experimentation. You know, again, this idea that, you know, I think people have a really tough time with modern art because it never quite, it's like, it looks like something they could have done, quote unquote, you know, and that I think people get a little bit too hung up on the idea that art somehow reaches its apex. It doesn't. It's a complete explosion of experimentation from all of these different artists who are trying out all these different things, because they've been given permission to actually look at a canvas and say, you are flat. You are never going to be an actual window onto the world. Photography has been developed. What can we do with you? Where can we go with you? And so Picasso is really interested in experimentation. This is a piece from a couple of years later that is no longer analytic cubism, but has moved over into synthetic cubism. And synthetic cubism is really collage, largely, you know, I mean, that's kind of the easiest way to talk about it, where you have artists who are adding patterns and found materials into their paintings. And the reason why I want to point this out is because in a lot of ways, a still life is timeless. You know, it's just, again, it's just an exercise, just a way of kind of, you know, experimenting. But with synthetic cubism and with these kinds of collages, they're actually remarkably time bound, because he integrates newspaper clippings into them and stories. And, you know, it's really actually tied to its moment. And this changes what we're looking at, because suddenly there are political connotations. If you're bringing in newspaper articles, then you are choosing what to bring in from the world also as it is being lived. You know, another really key element of modernism. And so when you bring in politics, you're allowing for a lot of multiple perspectives too. You know, maybe it's not just a million different perceptions of a woman, but it's people experiencing the world differently. And with, you know, a pretty powerful political moment at, you know, just before World War I, you know, that's going to affect the way that people are going to read this image. And so, for example, I mean, just this very image, we're looking at a bottle of Suze, which is a French aperitif that would have been very well known, kind of put up against articles of the First Balkan War and the horrors of that war. And this kind of side by side of a sense of kind of frivolity and very important political, you know, kind of an important political moment is also going to, you know, make people engage in a really different way. It shows that he's engaging in his moment in a different way and in a really interesting way, and kind of that multiple perspectives are taking place all the time. And I'd of course be remiss if we're bringing in, you know, the idea of politics and newspaper clippings, to not also actually reference Andy Warhol, who I know is also very meaningful to Bunny. You know, Warhol is the master of using newspapers and pop culture references, often as repetition. You know, you've seen all the soup cans, you've seen all the Marilyns. Here we're looking actually at multiple silk screens of an electric chair. He used repetition in order to show us how our own critical faculties, if we're all going in with our own perceptions, you know, that our critical faculties kind of deteriorate when we're shown the same thing over and over and over and over again. You know, that's still true today. You know, it's amazing how easy it is to stop seeing something when it's in your face all the time, or, you know, conversely, see it with a lot of intensity. I had a really interesting experience when I interviewed people in front of this this painting at the MFA Boston, because I was expecting, and the museum was expecting, people to be so kind of inundated by the repetition that they just kind of push it away. And they have a quote by Warhol saying that he was expecting people to do just that. And at the same time, when I actually talked to somebody about it, and he recognized that he was looking at electric chairs, he got very disturbed. He found that kind of being hit by one, another, and especially up against this really stark red, it made, you know, otherwise he would have just walked by this. And I kind of ruined his day, but I was kind of glad to, because it meant that he really was engaging with the work in a way that challenged Warhol's assumptions and challenged the MFA's assumptions. So, you know, again, we're always looking at subjectivity here and the individual response to hear kind of the political world. And so this idea also of engaging with pop culture, and engaging with collage and how to kind of bring in what Picasso is doing, this idea of bringing in newspaper articles and, you know, kind of the time-bound and the timeless side by side. Robert Rauschenberg was also an enormously influential painter for her. And his use of combines, which this isn't actually an example of that, but it's what he's very famous for. Artworks that would incorporate everyday objects, you know, not necessarily newspaper clippings, not necessarily something that actually kind of was evocative, but just everyday objects as materials that he would work into the painting. And it blurs the line between painting and sculpture, and it blurs the line between pop culture and high art. You know, you had pop artists, and Robert Rauschenberg's kind of, you know, he's a little uncategorizable, but he tends to be clumped with pop artists like Andy Warhol, who wanted to kind of identify this gap in between the world that we live in and like the world that artists live in, you know, the world that fine art lives in, and say, maybe there's art that you can mine and create in that space between. And you could get a sense that Rauschenberg actually found a lot of joy in that, that he found a lot of beauty in that. He has this great quote. He says, "I really feel sorry for people who I really feel sorry for people who think that things like soap dishes or mirrors or Coke bottles are ugly, because we're surrounded by these things all day long, and it must make them miserable." And I really like that, because it's incredible that with Rauschenberg's art, and with Andy Warhol's art, and with Jasper John's art, you know, all of these artists who are really, really interested, Klaus Oldenburg, who were really interested in integrating everyday objects and kind of pop culture references into their work, it didn't actually denigrate the work. It elevated the objects, and it made us look at these everyday objects differently. And there is a kind of joy in that, you know, that you can look at a Coke bottle differently, that you can look at, you know, I mean, ultimately, you can look at a urinal differently, if you want to bring this back to Marcel Duchamp and his ready-mades. I mean, that's a whole other lecture. But, you know, you have a lot of artists who are really interested in integrating our modern world and the kind of the consequences of modernity, which largely was mass production, especially post-war, into the art, and saying, you know, there's really something here, too, that's worth looking at. And, you know, why be miserable when you can find the joy in that? And at the same time, I think it's important to point out that you can't do that if you don't have a good eye. You can't actually bring in this kind of collage that goes in so many different directions if you don't have an eye like Robert Rauschenberg did, if you don't have an eye like Bunny did, and actually if you don't have an eye like my own mother does. I brought in some of her work. She's also an artist, and she's also been experimenting with abstraction for about 20 years now. And that it requires a certain kind of understanding of, you know, kind of the trained eye of realism, almost, where it's like you have to know how color balances, how composition balances, how there is a kind of rhythm and dynamism to the way things that look when they are balanced. And then you can upend it a little bit. Then you can kind of apply that to abstraction that is actually enormously beautiful to look at. And if you are drawn into it, then you're going to see what it's doing differently. You're going to see the materials and the collage materials that are integrated into it, I think, more clearly, because you're also looking at something that is just really aesthetically balanced. Okay, so moving on. Georgia O'Keeffe. Going back to these kinds of fundamental principles in my mind of what the Jewish soul is, we talked a little bit about the collective. And, you know, maybe this is pushing the metaphor a little far. I will accept that. But the idea of kind of the individual and the collective working in tandem is something that, to me, as in my own Judaism, I think it's very meaningful. They don't always work in tandem. And I think that there was an interesting role of the collective in our communal misunderstanding of what Georgia O'Keeffe was trying to do. And that is important too, you know, that sometimes the individual and the collective can kind of be at odds. And we're so used to looking at the trajectory of modern art as kind of this leads to this leads to this leads to this, that, you know, we forget that these are individual artists, even if they are working in movements with other artists, you know, they're still trying to experiment in their own way. You know, we know what Georgia O'Keeffe's iconic narrative is. And, you know, for better or for worse, people kind of have an idea of what they think they're looking at when they look at a Georgia O'Keeffe. And I mean, I'll just say it. I mean, you know, she's considered kind of the reigning queen of vagina flowers. And I want to not only kind of disabuse you of that idea, but explain really kind of where it came from. She was born in the Midwest to farmers. She always had an interest in art. She always had a talent for art. And she was very interested in abstraction early on. And so she would, this idea, again, we just kind of looked at abstraction. We talked about abstraction, the importance of balance and dynamism. And she loved the idea of the sensory stimulation of abstraction, of creating shapes that didn't necessarily exist in nature. And by zooming in so closely into a flower that you start to see things that wouldn't necessarily exist in nature, and especially with color. You know, imagine closing your eyes and pushing down on your eyelids and the way that colors kind of, you know, vibrate and you know, change from one to another. This is the what she was really interested in. The fluid and dynamic relationships between color and form. And she was kind of dinged for it. You know, she wasn't really taken seriously for her earlier abstraction. So she said, all right, you know what? I'm going to actually paint, you know, I'm going to zoom back out again. I'm going to paint the flower itself, paint the flower in its isolation. Also the way that Bunny does, you know, how do I show you a flower so that you really see that it's a flower? And at the time, again, she was from Wisconsin. She moved to New York. She married Stieglitz, the photographer Stieglitz, and you know, she kind of, you know, moved into his art scene. And so the work that she was doing when she was in New York is very different from what we associate with her. And you can almost picture her gulping for air, and why her work in the Southwest, when she ultimately moved to the Southwest, kind of really, you know, just opened up these skyscrapers that had been so oppressive to her. And so her interest in flowers too, really was a means of both kind of speaking to a desire to be in an airier, more organic place, but also kind of contrasting this man-made permanence of these skyscrapers with the kind of slow, languid blooming, you know, the organic impermanence of flowers. And she said that New Yorkers were really bad at seeing flowers, that was something that she had noticed in her time there, that, you know, she kind of brought this Midwestern sensibility to New York. And she said, you know, New Yorkers in particular never slow down enough to experience what a flower is like when it's blooming. And so if she can paint her own kind of subjective reality of what a flower is, then she said even New Yorkers will stop and smell it, you know, and really kind of experience it. And I see this in Bunny's flower too, you know, the fact that there's no background, the fact that it really is showing the flower in kind of its holistic sensibility, that this is something that really you'll stop and you'll notice even if you're a New Yorker. And, you know, so she then would say, you know, if you are seeing something erotic in this flower, that's your business. Basically, that was how she kind of responded to everybody looking at this and, you know, kind of making assumptions about what it was. But I would also argue that there is something pretty erotic in this black iris, you know, that it's not too far stretched to also say, you know, there is a kind of organic lushness, an interest in nature, an interest in sensuality that, you know, we can't be blamed for. If she is going to show us a flower, we're going to see into it everything a flower can be. You know, this is an element of her legacy that she was never able to shake in life, and she certainly has never been able to shake it in death. You know, and I don't mean to disparage the idea of a collective, especially, you know, especially from the point of view of, you know, the importance of it with the, you know, this idea of the Jewish soul. But there is a flip side. Like I said, you know, we can't let narratives, kind of communal narratives, take us away from the uniqueness of the individual. And so finally, I wanted to end with Rothko. And this is where we come back to this idea of an individual sense of mindfulness and meditation. And, you know, Rothko was a Jewish artist too, actually. And he moved away from organized religion when he was younger. He was confronted with a lot of anti-Semitism in his childhood. And so he didn't like to think of himself necessarily as Jewish, but as spiritual. And this spirituality is also a very emotional, very individual thing that people experience themselves when they look at his work. And I think that you can divide people basically into two groups. You know, people who come to a Rothko and just have this overwhelming emotional experience and really resonate with what they're looking at, and the people who look at them and say, I don't know why you're having that. You know, like, I don't know where that experience is coming from. I wish I had it too, but I don't know where it's coming from. And I think, you know, there are a lot of things you could say about that. You could say, well, maybe you just haven't found the right Rothko, or, you know, that maybe you're not necessarily giving it its due time. But I also don't think that it's fair to kind of force someone to have an emotional experience that they're not having. I wouldn't be surprised if in this group, more people were the former, more people kind of walked up to a Rothko and felt a kind of a sense of catharsis. And he wanted to create works that would have a meditative impact on people. He described his own work as kind of meditating in his own cathedral. He described in his words, he said that my work is not the painting of an experience, it is the experience. And that means that you stand in front of it, and if you really do give yourself the time, and if you never have before, take the time, stand in front of a Mark Rothko painting and focus on the way that the colors dissolve from one to another. Focus on the ways that they kind of pulse together. There's a beautiful kind of let down that your eye will have if you really stand in front of it and just kind of watch the layers dissolve into layers, dissolve into layers. And because it is such a subjective experience, everybody has very subjective ways of describing what a Rothko does to them or what they're seeing in a Rothko. I've also heard people say, you know, it's like kind of pushing against your eyelids when they're closed, that, you know, that's also kind of seeing these colors blend from one to another. And I should be clear, this is abstraction. You know, this is the lack of anything specific that is being represented, and instead inviting you into your own experience of looking at this kind of work. One of my favorite, actually, interpretations that somebody once said was that it, to them, a Rothko spoke to what came before God separated lightness and darkness at the beginning of Genesis. And so I want to actually kind of leave it there and leave you with this idea of meditation, stillness, soulfulness, and how we kind of understand how we've gotten here. As modernity has kind of brought us to this place. And you can see how these artists would be so influential on an artist as eclectic as Bunny, who's really interested in kind of understanding the 20th century through, you know, through her own experimentation and her own soulfulness. So I don't know how much time we have left, but I'm happy to kind of open up to Q&A. If there's anything you want to go more deeply into or talk more about, you've got me.
Well, I personally just want to thank you for that. It was very, very thoughtful, very, very moving, and very, very, very moving and very profound to me. And just wanted to thank you. If people have questions, I think the best way is to please just type it into the chat, since we have such a large group. And I personally am just kind of overwhelmed and just still processing. So I can't even formulate a question. But please just type in the chat or wave your hands on the screen. But I'm only seeing a small group on the screen. So your best bet is to just hit the chat.
No question, too big or small. And I'll also just advance one more slide. Gotta be my own.
Tamar, are you able to see the chat?
Oh, here we go. Okay. Okay, so more about the different ways of expressing subjectivity between different artists. I'm curious, I know I said no question too big, but I'd be curious kind of what you mean by that. You know, what specifically can we talk more about? Because, you know, I mean, describing any subject, I mean, you know, they were all subjective from each other, and all playing with subjectivity.
Simi, why don't you take yourself off mute and maybe you can elaborate on your question.
Yeah, okay, thanks. Can you say, like, you know, in some of them, it's shapes, and others, it's colors, and others, it's sort of directly, you know, things that look more directly familiar from everyday life, and the, like, what they're probing as expressing subjective, you know, perspective seems to change.
Absolutely.
Maybe from the, you know, review that you did, it also looks like it gets more and more further and further away from recognizable things, objects and scenes, and into more abstractions.
Yeah.
So does all that just sort of go under subjectivity, or,
yeah, well,
you know, is there more to say about level? I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, what's interesting is that, you know, even just that first slide of the four different kinds of post-impressionists, you know, the four different most famous ones, you have four different examples of artists who were really interested in tackling a different element of subjectivity. So with Van Gogh, it's very much the emotional elements of color. With Seurat, it was very much a kind of scientific objectivity of what happens when you put two colors side by side. How does your eye mix them? And, you know, that speaks to subjectivity because we all do that in our own heads. You know, we all have our own individual brains that are kind of processing color in different ways. And so he was really interested in that from the scientific perspective, kind of pseudo-scientific perspective. And then you have Gauguin, who, you know, there's a totally different narrative way that he's looking at subjectivity, because his, you know, he's famous for, you know, absconding to Tahiti and painting the world he wished he had seen. Because he didn't see that world. He saw a world that was actually far more modernized than he kind of in his romantic ideology wanted to see. And so instead of painting women wearing clothes, which they would have worn, he painted them nude. You know, and so that's also kind of an example of seeing what you want to see through your own subjective reality. And so that's just the representative side. You know, it doesn't take very long for artists to recognize that, you know, representation such as it was had kind of been done. And so they wanted to see again, like they recognized that the canvas was flat and the entire you know, philosophy of art from the Renaissance was that if you are painting something, it has to have a kind of precision and exactness to it and a realistic, you know, ness to it, that it could be like looking out the window. And so once you're given permission to say, well, actually, you're never going to be, like I said, you're never going to look out the window and capture the world. What then do you choose to focus on? And the flatness of the canvas was a really big part of that. And little by little, but also very quickly, abstraction becomes a really interesting way of trying to identify what modernity looked like, what subjectivity looked like. And so, you know, yeah, very quickly you get to Jackson Pollock, very quickly you get to Mark Rothko. And, you know, a lot of times the kind of the representation of something becomes too fixed, and instead you really want the visitor or the viewer to see something of their own if you're a Rothko, or to kind of get inside the artist's head if you're Pollock, you know. But there's a, that is kind of how subjectivity evolves in the 20th century, and maybe, you know, and maybe kind of devolves, like how the art object devolves into something else. Does that help? Okay. What is the difference? Yeah.
Sorry. I was wondering if you could tell us a little more about Egon Schiele, because there's actually a self-portrait that my mother did that is, when you put the slide up with this painting on the brown paper, but actually the drawing, his self-portrait with the nude in between, is a drawing my mother did, a self-portrait of her looking at herself in the mirror. Hmm. And it really was like shocking to me, like very reminiscent. So maybe you could just share a little more about Schiele and his life and legacy.
Oh, well,
because I don't know whether intended or not, but it certainly seems resonant.
I don't know any artist who doesn't look at Schiele and hold him up as one of the gold standards of draftsmanship. You know, and so I think that it makes a lot, you know, art historians will recognize his place in the world, you know, in the canon, but artists are really drawn to Schiele because of the incredible specificity and virtuosity of his line. You know, he could tell the entire story of a woman in one line, as we saw. And his life was actually pretty tragic. He was always, I mean, you can imagine the kind of kid he was. You know, his teachers hated him. He was always drawing, you know, never paying attention. He took his work to Klimt and said, you know, do I have any talent, basically, as a teenager? And, you know, the I think it's kind of apocryphal, but the response was, yes, too much. You know, you're just like, he had an intensity about him. And I think that, so he and Klimt died in 1918. They both died of the Spanish flu. And Klimt was in his 50s at that point, but Schiele was only 28. And so there's a sense with Schiele, I think people kind of read into his work this incredible, heady, adolescent eroticism that I think was largely there, that he probably would have outgrown if he had gotten the chance, but he never got the chance. And so his work is enormously sexualized. And, you know, he drew, you know, again, kind of this like psychoanalytical way of kind of getting to the core of people. He had no problem drawing nude after nude after nude, and, you know, often in pretty scandalous positions. And of course he, you know, he was, I'm sure, a very sexual guy. But that's what I actually love so much about that drawing of the model, is because he's not leering at her. She's kind of leering at herself a little bit, but he is, you know, his intensity there is capturing the drawing, capturing the line, not trying to like get into her pants. And so I think that that really speaks to really what Sheila is about. You know, it was kind of the art first. And then he had an interesting kind of run-in with the law, actually, because he violated some decency laws by drawing a couple of things. I mean, he had drawn some underage girls, and then also a girl who was underage ran away from home and ended up staying with him and his girlfriend at the time. And, you know, as far as we know, nothing happened. But just the fact that there was an underage girl living with him, he was thrown into jail for a couple of weeks. And his drawings from jail are worth checking out. You can actually Google them, the Sheila prison drawings, because he didn't have a mirror. It's the only time in his entire kind of oeuvre that he doesn't have a mirror. And you see him lose his mind. I mean, you see the drawings devolve in a way, and his kind of his own mental state deteriorates by not having the mirror to kind of draw from. And it's interesting, you know, it really kind of changed his whole sensibility. He came out of prison and his works, it just didn't get, like, it didn't stay as interesting after that, I think because he was pretty scared. And then he died. So, you know, his work, like kind of the fieriest of his work, is 1915 or so. And then he died in 1918.
Well, thank you very much. You've been very generous with your time, and we are a little bit over. And again, I just want to thank you for coming and sharing with us this evening. And thank you everyone for joining us.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
It's subscribe to her podcast. You won't be disappointed.
Yes, please do.
All right. Good night, everybody. Take care.
Fun.
Thank you. Bye.